if you look at almost any successful organization in any sector of the world, whether it's corporations that are trying to make money, whether it's the legal profession that's doing the litigation piece, whether it's the healthcare industry and trying to help people in a hospital, all of them have some sort of planning process that they undertake. Just a simple framework. And the important thing is to remember that you can have a very simple framework, but the key is to have a process that's repeatable and it's predictable so that everyone in an organization actually knows what that process is and can contribute to it. Because the true strength of having a fully promulgated planning process is bringing in everyone in the organization and leveraging all of the intellectual abilities of the team and not just a few people that have been anointed as, say, a planner. Most militaries use some sort of saying that goes along these lines. The best plan never survives first contact with the enemy. In the humanitarian space, you could say the best humanitarian plan never survives first contact with a disaster or a humanitarian crisis. But it's a true statement. The real magic of planning is that it's not about the plan. It's about the planners, the people, understanding the environment they're operating in, and then being able to constantly adjust the plan. There's a great quote from Winston Churchill, and actually it's been used by several other military commanders over the course of many years. The plan means nothing, planning is everything. And what does that mean? It's the minute that you create the plan and you promulgate it, whether it's a fancy PowerPoint slideshow, or whether it's something that you wrote down on paper, whether it's a humanitarian snapshot or dashboard that shows what's going on, that's immediately irrelevant, because it's the constant planning that continues to adjust the actions and activities you take that's the real magic. It's the people that understand the context and are able to apply changes to future actions. That's where you make your money from using a planning process. Planning, without a doubt, can benefit any organization in the humanitarian sector, whether you're a small organization and you elect to take on a very simple framework for a small group of people that will undertake any type of planning activity, be it financial, be it operational response, moving food, moving aid, evacuating people, doesn't matter. Or you're a large organization and you have a more sophisticated planning cycle that you develop. The reason being is, if you think about anything you do in life, the more effectively you plan as an individual, ultimately the better your result typically is. Whether you're gonna go on a vacation somewhere, you're doing anything at work related to your job, the more time you put in thinking about your actions before you take them, typically the better the outcome is. Most international militaries in the world have a promulgated formal planning process. You can find a pretty broad range of actual steps in the planning process, but they typically run between 5 and 7 steps. Just to give you an example of what that might look like, the first step is almost always some sort of analysis that's done on the environment you're going to be operating in. The second step is, once the analysis is complete, is actually developing options. You'll often hear militaries refer to those as courses of action, COAs as the acronym. Once you have courses of action developed, we do typically a step called wargaming. Wargaming is thinking about an action you're going to take and what the adversary or the environment's reaction might be to those actions. That's very helpful in deciding if an action you're going to take is going to be effective, if that action is going to be efficient. The next step in the process would be taking the recommended course of action to a commander who's in charge of an organization, having he or she take a look at all the work you've done and actually make a decision on what actions you're going to ultimately take. And then last but not least, putting it into a written order that you can hand out to a large organization of hundreds or thousands or even 10,000s of people that they will go execute out in the field. The term wargaming, which is one of the critical steps in almost every planning process international militaries use, it may not sound like it fits well in the humanitarian sector, but in fact it does. It actually is critically important in the humanitarian space. So you can take away the term war and just call it gaming if you want. Another term that's often used is a red cell. So the red cell meaning it's an adversary. I like to think of any humanitarian crisis is the adversary is actually the aftermath of a crisis. So it's people suffering, potentially people getting killed, people starving, needing some sort of aid. So in the humanitarian context, thinking about any action that you're going to take as an organization, whether it's in the development space or actually in the humanitarian response space for a disaster. Every action is going to have some sort of reaction, whether it's from a person or from the environment. So just spending any time at all, whether it's a few minutes, a few hours, or even a few days, if you've got the time, to think about the implications of each specific action your organization would be undertaking, it might allow you to refine and become more effective and more efficient in how you plan and ultimately execute your humanitarian operation. The needs assessment is the critical first step of any formal planning process, but it doesn't end there. To do analysis at the very beginning, when you initiate a formal planning process to respond to any type of complex emergency or natural disaster, you need to have a basic understanding of what the needs are. Is it water? Is it food? Is it shelter? Is it security? But as you start to build an understanding, and as you work through the steps of a formal planning process to ultimately decide what actions you're going to take, it's really important to continue that assessment. And it's an ongoing iterative process that feeds the entire decision-making process. So the planning process never really ends. You continue to execute and refine the decisions that you've made each day and sometimes even each hour of a humanitarian operation. During that response, getting that updated assessment and allowing that to improve how you're using your resources, which are often very limited resources, limited people, limited finance, limited supplies. The needs assessment is possibly the most important point to do, and often the part that's ignored, because early on, there's a lack of general understanding of what is needed. I think the information communication technology arena and some of the remote sensing work that's being done, all these innovations in the humanitarian space, are going to allow us to be better planners in the humanitarian sector moving forward, because we are going to have more information. We're going to have more accurate information. The only issue is we might have information overload. Big data is definitely changing the way humanitarian responses are being conducted. It could, if we institute a formal planning process where applicable and where appropriate, it might allow us to ultimately all become better at providing coordinated responses across many different stakeholders. If you look at a large organization, say the United Nations Office for the Coordination of Humanitarian Affairs, when they have a humanitarian response that necessitates more than one agency within the UN, that they're going to be helping to manage that response with other organizations, they will typically undertake the humanitarian program cycle, which is a simple framework to understand, five steps, but it essentially allows them to do exactly what militaries would do, which is analyze the problem, think about how they're going to mobilize their resources in response to that problem, and most importantly, really share information across multiple stakeholders and coordinate effectively with many other organizations and actors that are going to be operating in that same environment, doing many different things, all towards one common objective, which is helping people that have been impacted by some sort of emergency. So you can look at the humanitarian program cycle, and typically the output of that is a UN humanitarian response plan. And it's going to have very high-level strategic objectives and activities that come out of that. And then that higher-level humanitarian response plan is typically broken down into two things: a country strategy for the country that's been impacted, and then a cluster plan for each of the clusters that's actually been activated to respond. So you can look, no matter how big your humanitarian organization is, if you're operating in that country where UN OCHA has operated and has executed that humanitarian program cycle, you could take a look at their higher level strategic objectives and the activities that they plan on undertaking. That'll allow you within that particular cluster then to look at the specific things that will focus on, say, nutrition or shelter or wash. And you can align yourself not only with the UN, but optimally with the other organizations that are going to be operating in the same environment as you. An excellent opportunity for an organization is to take a look at an existing response that has already been executed and to go back and try to take a retrospective look and start at the beginning by looking at the information you had at the start of that crisis and then work through the planning process and war game it based on the knowledge you had at the very beginning and work the entire team through that process in a very easy simulation. Do it on a tabletop, pull out a map, pen and paper, and work through that process. And that'll give you a deeper appreciation and the ability later to apply it for the next crisis. Another benefit of implementing a formal planning process for a humanitarian organization is built in or baked in to that plan is typically some sort of risk mitigation process. And again, by analyzing the risks, thinking about the actions you might take, thinking about the impact of those actions and potential reactions from the environment, that will inform both risk to people within your organization, whether it's a security risk, whether it's a risk of potential financial loss to your organization, or risk from a contextual perspective on the environment you're going to operate in. Do no harm. Are the actions you're going to potentially undertake, might those actually have an adverse effect on people in need versus helping them? So risk mitigation is a critical thing to consider, and you can actually put that right into the planning process that you create for your organization or pull in from another organization into yours that allows you to be smarter and more efficient and effective from a risk management perspective. From a military perspective, typically we talk about risk in two ways. We talk about the risk of an organization not being able to accomplish its mission. So that's the higher level one. If we've been told to go in and evacuate people out of harm's way, when we think about undertaking that mission, we think about we need to get those people and we need to move them from a place where they're in danger to what we call a safe haven, a place where they can be cared for and security is provided for them. They have food and water and shelter. The other risk that we think about is risk to our people within that military organization. Are the actions or activities they're going to undertake going to put them in harm's way? Might they get injured? Might they get killed? So we think about risk to mission and forces in virtually everything we're going to undertake, and we constantly reanalyze and assess the risk as we move through different phases of an operation. From a humanitarian perspective, there's been less of a focus on a formal risk assessment and mitigation methodology. There's an excellent policy paper that came out back in January of 2011 from the Humanitarian Policy Group. I love it because it actually looks at risk focused on humanitarian emergencies. And it essentially breaks it down into three different types of risks. The first is contextual risk. So risk to the people within a nation that have been impacted. Are those people going to suffer? Might those people get killed? Might those people not get aid that they need? So it looks at it from the human element of people that are in harm's way. The second element that it looks at is programmatic risk. So if a humanitarian organization is going to respond, might they not be able to accomplish their mission in a particular area they're responding in, whether it's shelter, whether it's nutrition, whether it's protection, whether it's wash. The last is institutional risk, and that's the risk to the humanitarian organization's people or finances. So if you take those three risks in the Humanitarian Policy Group paper and actually think about them and program those in to your planning process, where you analyze risk during each step of the process so that when you make a decision on what actions and activities you're going to take in a humanitarian emergency response, you'll be well informed and you will hopefully put your people and the people you're trying to help in less of a situation where they could be injured, hurt, or killed. If I think about humanitarian organizations over the next few years actually starting to create formal planning processes that actually build in the risk mitigation piece, I feel like there's going to be tremendous success at a much higher level and in a much more meaningful way than when militaries respond to a humanitarian crisis, primarily because of humanitarian actors' deep understandings of the challenges that exist in each sector of the humanitarian space. So if you were to look at a particular logistics challenge in a nation like Syria, and then you layer on top of that the protection challenges that exist trying to get access to civilians in some of the cities that have been under siege, as well as just trying to get shelter for people that have been displaced from their homes and are fleeing a conflict setting, you're going to find that humanitarian organizations, I would argue, are going to have a much higher probability of creating really meaningful, effective, and probably more efficient responses because they've used a rigorous process, even though it's a simple process, to think more about those actions that they might take before they take them. I think this major shift we've seen over the past 5 to 10 years, in particular the new threats to aid workers and humanitarians that are in some of these conflict settings, operating in a complex emergency, I think they necessitate the humanitarian sector to take another look at how it assesses risk. The simple way to do it is to take just any risk assessment framework that's out there and modify it for your particular organization you're operating in. But really, you're taking both a quantitative and a qualitative look. Trust me, it's not science, it's art. And you're going to examine the risk that your people are going to put themselves in, and you're also going to examine the risk that you are going to put an affected nation's people in, those vulnerable people that you're trying to help. It's going to let you ultimately make smarter, more effective, and more efficient decisions in how you're going to mobilize your resources and how you're going to employ your people in some of these really complex environments. The question I always get asked is, so what's the one thing I can do? I think the one thing you can do is think about, does the organization you work for have a formal planning process that's understood from leadership at the highest level all the way down to the newest person in an organization? And if it doesn't, because you're in this extraordinary program on humanitarian leadership, then perhaps you can be the person to institute and initiate a new planning process, a formal planning process. Keep it simple. Make sure it's predictable. Make sure it's repeatable. But institute it. And don't wait to try it out during the next humanitarian emergency. Run a small simulation where you bring the whole staff in and you practice it for a few hours. And then over time, people will become comfortable with it. And ultimately, you could use it in the real world for a real crisis.